Hi everyone, it's Terry. Tonight we started a new Bible study at my church on Mark. And I really had to talk with God. I had signed up to go do it, and I was really wondering whether I should, because, you know, I'm just like bursting with excitement about Jesus coming back for us. And I know a lot of y'all on YouTube are the same way, but the rest of the folks aren't. I don't know why, you know, I don't know if they're just too busy with their lives. I know these are godly people. So I don't know if it's because I've got some special role. You know, some people call themselves watchmen. I don't know if I've got some special role that I'm supposed to be trying to sound the alarm, but it gets very discouraging. And I was like, really, God, if I go, you know, I want to talk about you coming back and I can't, you know, there'll be like 10 women at my table who, you know, young mothers, people that are working full time. And, you know, maybe it's just that I've been blessed with that he started speaking to me first before I ever even asked. And so I hear a lot from him. But anyway, as I was driving there, I hadn't really been thinking about doing a video. But as I was driving there, I was thinking about that some people are communicating to me that they're concerned that they're not ready to go in the rapture. I wanted to talk about, or I felt led to talk about, what is really a born-again Christian versus someone who thinks they're a Christian. Because I thought I was a Christian. And I really, it all boils down to relationship with Jesus. So if you are a person who knows about Jesus, and you can even read your Bible and go to church and all that, and you know about Jesus, but it's not a relationship, an intimate relationship with Jesus. You know, the Bible says we're to examine ourselves to see whether we're really in the faith. And it also says to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Now, you know, people who are like so far on the grace side, maybe even hyper grace, they don't like those two scriptures. You know, how few churches even try to warn people about taking communion when there's something, some reason, which is in the Bible, it's in 1 Corinthians, I think, that says, you know, you're not supposed to take it if you haven't made something right with your, or attempted to make something right with someone that has something against you. So I just wanted to talk about what I believe proves, or things to ask yourself to prove whether or not it is a knowledge of who Jesus is, even maybe what he's done on the cross, versus actually having the Holy Spirit inside you. I don't want to scare anybody, but then also I want to say, just wake up, you know. And I'm not the judge of who's going to heaven or not, but I just really, I think God just wants a really, he wants us to be looking to see, or those of us who know him really well, he's wanting us to say, hey, look into these things and see if you really have the Holy Spirit. And if not, repent and ask to receive the Holy Spirit, you know, the seal of our salvation that Jesus gives us. So as you know, I've done another video on about hearing from God, and to me, that is the best way to have assurance that I've got the Holy Spirit. Just this week, for instance, I went into, and you know, I'm a 12-year-old Christian. God started speaking to me for 9 months before I actually surrendered and told him he could take my life, and I received the Holy Spirit inside, and life has not been the same. But this week, for instance, I went to the hospital to visit with my dog, my sweet little dog, who, Lexi, come here, up, come on. I was gonna show her to you. There she is. Lexi, look at the camera. There she is. She's a golden doodle. And so anyway, she loves people, and we go to the hospital. You really did get a good look at her right there, Lexi. Yeah, Lexi, look at the camera. All right. Good girl. Okay, so as I walked into this room, I realized that there was a man that I had met the week before, and I just said, God, I need to know his name. And I said to the man, I said, is your name Michael? He goes, yeah, how'd you know? I said, I just asked God, and he told me. He's like, really? And I said, yes, and God knows you, and he knows your name. So, you know, that's, first of all, that just really encourages me, but it also encourages somebody who's going through troubles. You know, he didn't tell me what his faith was, but God obviously loves him and knows his name. God knows everybody's name, and whether they know him or not, right? Okay, and then I went into another room, and you know how it is, when you have the Holy Spirit, you can meet a person when you first meet them, it's almost like your spirit is just drawn. You're just like connected, just like right away. And it turned out we have the same name, Terry with a Y. And I just was like, she said something about Jesus, and I said, so you know he's coming back soon? And she said, oh yes. And the next thing you know, we're hugging and jumping up and down, and the other volunteer with me, who is, I don't believe she's a believer because she hasn't said a single thing about it, and she looks at us like we are nuts. You know, they just don't understand. So I would say one of the big signs is hearing from the Lord. You know, I said that I was going to be reading this book. Jesus Speaks. Yeah. My sheep know my voice and they follow me. Got that? To me, it is something you have to learn how to do. It starts out by saying, training your ears to hear. But Jesus does speak to his sheep. And depending on what he says, that's what we are to obey. You know, we're to be asking him what his will is for making decisions. He wants to give us the answer, but we have to be not walking pridefully or like we are the ones that make the decisions. And we need to, I think the first chapter says, talking about having childlike faith and childlike ears. We need to be still and quiet and ask God yes or no questions. So, hearing from God. There's a book which I really like. I've read like 15 or 20 books because I think you can always get better at it. But this is called Hearing God 30 Different Ways by Larry Kreider, K-R-E-I-D-E-R. Lexi, stop that. And God does speak to us in different ways. So he can, the ways that I find most common, he speaks in the middle of the night, or he speaks first thing in the morning when you're just coming out of sleep, Or if you ask him a question and you're quiet, he will give you an answer. And as you get better and better at it, he will even give you answers like, what is that person's name? And he's done that for me a few times at the hospital. So he speaks in the still small voice. It's not a voice. It's just that the answer comes to your mind. Yes, no. I had a woman ask me to pray for her about a decision she had to make. And I asked God for a week. I'm like, God, I need to give her an answer. And finally he said, the answer is yes, and California. And it turned out she was asking about whether she should leave her job, and she had already given notice. And she had she wasn't moving to California, but she was applying for a job that had California involved in it. So that's how we build each other up, by listening to God, being used by the Holy Spirit. That's how you know you've got the Holy Spirit, right? Because the Holy Spirit is to guide us, to comfort us, to direct us, to teach us. The Holy Spirit, when we're reading the Bible, he's the one that makes these verses go, that's the verse for you today. And also, he's the one that writes the word on our hearts. I can't remember if it's in Psalm 119. That's another excellent thing. Read Psalm 119. It's the longest chapter in the Bible, but it is, if you can read it out loud and say that that is true about me, I think that's all the assurance that you need, because it is about thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. It's about how I obey God. You know, he is God. We have nothing good about us. Even our righteous deeds are filthy rags to God. The only things that are going to be survive the Bema Seat of Judgment, which is for believers when they meet Jesus, all of the stuff that we did, going through the motions, going to church, reading our Bible, but not really paying attention to what God was trying to tell us, all those things that we did because, of course I'm supposed to do this because it seems like a good thing. You know, there are good things that we're supposed to do, but then there are things that God has ordained for us to do. And that is really what we're supposed to be doing. And if we get so full of doing things that are not what God wants us to do, that are technically good things, we are not available for doing the things that he has prepared us in advance to do, which is Ephesians 1 and 2, I think. I find most often that God gives me just a lyric to a song or a word in scripture that he wants me to study that word. Lately I've been getting dreams. I've had visions. Two open-eyed and some closed. He gives you spiritual gifts. And as you use those spiritual gifts and you go, wow, I didn't do that in my own strength. That was just the Holy Spirit enabled me to do that. Then as you use your spiritual gifts, he gives you more spiritual gifts. And that's the point of spiritual gifts. They are not talents. They are not something that you're naturally good at. It's something that God does for you. He equips you to do it, and then he does it through you. If you haven't taken a spiritual gift test, I would start there. Time is running out, though. Time is running out. And so, and another thing, you know, people get the whole thinking when Jesus says, I would rather you be hot or cold versus lukewarm. If you're lukewarm, I'm going to vomit you out, when he was speaking to the church of Laodicea, which I think is in Revelation 3. He said hot or cold. People get that confused. But it's the reason why is cold doesn't mean that you're cold-hearted towards God. It means that you're refreshing and reviving, and, you know, like a cold glass of water, or that you're hot, you're like on fire and passionate for God. He just does not want us going through the motions. And I went through the motions from, well, until I was 45, I was going through the motions. So, let me think if there's anything else that I'm supposed to say as far as, well, look to see, you know, ask. I mean, I know someone who realized she didn't have any spiritual gifts. She was in church all the time. And that's when she repented and said, God, I don't have the Holy Spirit, and I repent, and please fill me with your Spirit. I know other people that have come to Christ because they've asked God to speak to them. I know people that have asked, well, and Fairy on my YouTube channel, I've got her testimony. She just asked God to reveal himself, and he showed up. She saw Jesus. It seems like it does start with God pursuing us, causing us to ask questions about who he is, and do I really have him, or I need to get to know him better. One of my favorite verses is James 4:8, draw close to God and he'll draw close to you. But that also makes me think of seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, or he rewards those who diligently seek him. All of these scriptures, it's the Holy Spirit that puts them inside you, and you become a walking Bible. And actually, that's how you fight the spiritual battles too, because the scriptures he speaks to us primarily through his word, but then his word, as it is indwelling with us with the Spirit, he brings to mind, or he will give us a song with the lyrics that will, as I did recently, that stand up for Jesus, you soldiers at the cross, after I'd had a dream about being a soldier. The 30 different way, I mean, he can speak through nature. He can speak, some people have felt a physical touch, a hug, a touch on their head. Fairy felt kisses on her head from Jesus. There are just lots of different ways, but I think what it all does boil down to is in the relationship with Jesus, you are experiencing God. Now, I never did the Blackaby study on experiencing God, but I know it's a popular study, but I know people who've done it that have no experience. Or like I did, I was in a Bible study. We were doing Priscilla Shirer's two books, which are really two of my favorite. He Speaks to Me, Preparing to Hear God's Voice, and Discerning the Voice of God. And I was the only one in the group that was hearing from God. And not that I was proud of it, but I was disappointed. I felt bad for them. And then it ended up, they got so jealous and everything. And I was like, finally, God, what am I going to do? And he told me, he said, you're done. And so I just called him up and I said, I've got another thing I'm going to be doing on Wednesday mornings, but I want this for everybody. I want everybody to realize. And if you haven't heard from God, beg him to speak to you. Get a book about him speaking. Priscilla Shirer's book's great. This book that I'm reading is really good so far. Larry Kreider's book is good. Steve Sampson has a book. I'll try to put some of the names in the whatever the little box is below. But really, it's so assuring. Assuring? It boosts your assurance, your blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. That's the thing. It's like all these songs, all these hymns and songs. You know, God uses these songwriters and these lyricists to also give his word. And You know, it's funny, I had this little poem on my refrigerator about repentance, and I kept trying to memorize it, and then finally one day I just walked up to it, and God just gave me the tune for the song that fit, for the poem that fit perfectly so that I could remember it. It's repentance is, no. Figures I put myself on the spot because I just randomly thought about it. Repentance is to leave the sins you loved before and show that you in earnest grieve by doing so no more. It's really, it boils down to that the woman who was caught in adultery was forgiven of her adultery. And Jesus says, I don't condemn you, but go and sin no more. So if she had just gone and kept on committing adultery, she would prove that she didn't have, she didn't receive Jesus' forgiveness. And particularly for our day, yes, we still sin, we still mess up, but, you know, the Holy Spirit convicts the world of sin, but he also convicts us of sin. And he actually, it says in, but it says that once we've received the Holy Spirit, he shows us a way out. And, you know, there have been people who have miraculous stories about being delivered instantaneously of major sins. And I have to say, I was instantaneously delivered of two major sins, really. But, you know, I'm still not perfect. And but he tells you, like, I guess I can't include it. There's a list of sins of omission and sins of commission. And, you know, just there's a verse in James that says, if you know what is right to do it and you don't do it, that is sin also. So we can sin by omission and sin by commission. And that's another thing. If you have the Holy Spirit, you ask him, how am I sinning? Tell me. I don't want to sin against you. Tell me how I'm sinning and help me, deliver me from that sin. Okay, I think that's what I've got to say. I want everyone to know if they need to repent and they don't have the Holy Spirit yet, or if they have the Holy Spirit, to know for sure that they're going to go be with Jesus. So it is something, it's worth your time to spend time examining yourself. And if there's any way I can help anybody, just put a comment in and I'll try to help. But I'll put in those books, and but you know, you also can sit down with the Bible and just ask God to have you open to the page that he wants you to do, and he does that too. He's done that for me. He did it for me before I was even surrendered to the Lord and had been born again. I said, God, what do you want to show me? Show me. I know the Bible's alive. Show it to me. So I'm praying for y'all, and I'm also praying for the spiritual warfare that we're experiencing. Let's try to finish well, right? Even though it's discouraging, it is discouraging. Aren't we grateful that Jesus came and he's already rescued us once by giving us the Holy Spirit and really taking us out of this world already. But soon he'll come to call us up into the clouds. So I love you, and I'm praying for you. God bless you. Bye-bye.